Hi, so for my topic, I am constructive and destructive interference. So I'm going to start this video out by just defining what waves are. So a wave is a disturbance that propagates or moves from the place it started. So I'll have you guys pause this video and see if you can come up with a couple different types of waves. So here's the list of some of the waves that I came up with. We have water waves, sound waves, earthquake waves, and radio waves. And in each different type of these waves, there gets their disturbance from a different source. So in the water waves, you'll get the disturbance on the surface of the water. In sound waves, you get the disturbance from the change in air pressure. Earthquake waves, you get the disturbance from the pressure underneath the Earth's surface, and then radio waves. So I just have some pictures of some of my types of wave examples. Here we have just water waves, and so they look very familiar, you know, if you've been to the ocean. Here we have our sound waves and radio waves. And then your seismic activity waves. So it gets broken up into the different types of wave. They have P wave, S wave, and surface waves. All these waves may look very different from each other, but the fundamental wave has a couple different characteristics that they all have in common. So here are some of the characteristics that waves have. You have your period, which isn't something you can really label, but your period is a time for one complete up and down motion. So however long it took to come from here, 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 that is called your period. It can be measured in any units of time, seconds, minutes. Then you have your amplitude. It's the maximum extent of one propagation from the point of equilibrium. So here, this orange line is the equilibrium line. From here to the top of the wave is the amplitude. Then you have your maximum or minimums of your wave. So the minimum as the trough, maximum as your crest, and those two words are really interchangeable. And then you have some other characteristics like wave frequency and wave velocity. Now, those both have their own separate equations, but wave frequency and wave velocity are the speed at which the disturbance moves, and I will provide the equations for them. Here are some equations to help you determine the numerical values of some of those characteristics. So we have the frequency equals 1 over your period. So given one or the other, you could solve for either one. And as you can see, by the way this equation is set up, the frequency is just the reciprocal of the period. Then you have a couple different equations for wave velocity, and one of them is the wavelength over the period, and another one is frequency times the wavelength. So given any of these values, you should be able to plug them in and solve for a different variable. So here is a blank wave, and I labeled some of the characteristics that we went over earlier in the video. So pause this and see if you can give each one of these labels the name of the characteristic of the wave. Okay, so here are the answers. This is your trough, your crest, your amplitude, or your position from the equilibrium to the maximum height of your peak, and wavelength. So the wavelength is then just the distance between two successive or identical either peaks, as in crests, or this would be considered a wavelength as well, from trough to trough. So there are two specific types of waves. We have transverse waves or longitudinal waves. And all waves are either one or the other, or a combination of both. So pause this video and see if you can come up with what these two waves would look like by yourself. So here are pictures of the two different types of waves. And the transverse wave is kind of the basic one that we've been drawing thus far. And then you have your longitudinal wave, which looks more like a spiral bound chord thing. So a transverse wave propagates horizontally, and its disturbance of the chord is in the vertical direction. So the disturbance is perpendicular to the propagation, as opposed to the longitudinal wave, which also propagates horizontally, but then the disturbance is also in the horizontal direction. So the disturbance is parallel to the direction of the wave. Okay, so now we're going to do a little guessing game. So I listed just a few different types of waves, and go ahead and pause it and see if you can answer whether this particular wave would be transverse, longitudinal, or a combination of both. Okay, so a sound wave is actually only one, and it is longitudinal. A water wave is actually a combination of both. Musical string instruments are strictly transverse waves. Electromagnetic waves are also strictly transverse. And last but not least, we have our earthquake waves, which, like water, is a combination of both. So the thing about waves is they're not always just that simple, like just longitudinal or just transverse. So most waves are complex waves, so there are several simple waves added together. So that happens through a phenomenon called superposition. So superposition is a phenomenon where two or more waves arrive at the same point in phase, superimposing their two disturbances. So here is an example. Each disturbance corresponds to a force, and the forces add. So before superposition, you have two waves coming together. During superposition, these two forces will add together to create a larger force. And after superposition, the two disturbances will continue on their same way. So superposition creates either constructive interference or destructive interference. So we said that superposition either creates constructive or destructive interference, but this requires the waves to be perfectly aligned. Here I drew two pictures, and pause this video and see if you can guess which one is constructive and which one's destructive. So our left is an example of constructive interference, and our right is an example of destructive interference. In constructive interference, you have the adding of disturbances that are exactly in phase, and this creates a wave that has double the amplitude. So it adds this amplitude with this amplitude, creating 2x amplitude, but it has the same wavelength. With destructive interference, you are adding the amplitudes of waves that are exactly out of phase. So you're adding like a negative x and an x, so these two amplitudes together, since they're out of phase, it produces a wave with a zero amplitude. So it's like these disturbances and these two waves canceled. So here I'm going to put some numerical values into this equation to prove the constructive and destructive interference. So I have an equation x equals x1 plus x2. Let's start with destructive. So we know that in the first wave it has an amplitude of positive 2. So you just go to the equilibrium point and then determine that amplitude value. And then in the second wave, we go to the equilibrium point and find its amplitude value of a negative 2. So if you were to plug it into our equation, we would get this. Proving that adding your amplitudes together gets you a zero value for your second wave. If we were to do the same thing for this wave, you can try it yourself, but I'll just do it really quick. you can see that since both amplitudes are above the equilibrium point, they're both positive 2, and they'll get you a positive 4 final wave value. So here I drew something a little bit different, and I just want you guys to think about maybe what's going on and why our resultant wave looks like this. So here in our resultant wave, we can see that it looks nothing like just a longitudinal or just a transverse. And so the superposition of waves that are non-identical produce a resultant wave that has both characteristics of constructive and destructive interference. So here's a question to think about. What type of waves does a stereo produce, and how do you explain the varying loudness? So stereo waves are actually a combination of both constructive and destructive interference, and that's why you hear the varying sound levels, and that's just partial constructive characteristics and partial destructive characteristics at different times along that wave. So here is another example of constructive and destructive interference. This is a type of wave resulting from both of the interferences called a standing wave. A standing wave is a wave created by the superposition of two identical waves moving in opposite directions. So here we can see that they are in fact moving in opposite directions, and the oscillations are at fixed moments in space, and they are resulting from the different interferences. So where they meet up are at the equilibrium point is called a node, and that is where the wave disturbance is collectively zero. And then where it's at an antinode is where the wave disturbance are at its maximum moments. So here I drew another example, and quiz time, pause this video and see if you can come up with a number of nodes and antinodes that this example has. So if you got 11 and 10, then you would be correct. And all you have to do for the nodes is just count where the wave disturbance is zero, and then antinodes, count the maximums. So further talking about standing waves, we can start referring to them based off their frequencies. So you can split standing waves into different levels per se. The first one is your fundamental frequency, which means, pictured here, it has the lowest frequency and longest wavelength. And then you can increase the frequency and shorten the wavelength, and you get your second harmonic and your third harmonic. With standing waves, you can also figure out a beat frequency, and a beat frequency is just the number of beats per second, or the differences in frequencies between two different oscillations. So it's just the frequency of 1 minus the frequency of 2. Okay, so now I just have a couple quiz questions for you guys. So if you want to pause the video and answer these, and then check me after. Okay, so constructive interference will cause the wave to increase its displacement, or the distance covered. Destructive interference occurs when the crest of one wave lines up with the trough of another. And that makes sense, because then that will give the wave interference of 0. Okay, I have a couple more quiz questions for you guys, so if you just want to pause it and give them a shot. Okay, so in observing two interfering waves, the amplitude of the resulting wave can be found at every single point using the principle of superposition. Remember, they just had to be aligned perfectly. Interference can occur with all types of waves, not super selective. And two stereo speakers can be set side by side, so there are some places in front of them where the sound is diminished, and that is true because of the combination of constructive and destructive interference. See if it'll fit right, that's just the way.